This video is about the paper Neural Backed Decision Trees, or NBDTs in short. This paper constructs a decision tree using an underlying neural network's weights, using which highly accurate interpretable models can be built. But what do I mean when I say interpretable models? So interpretability of a model is its property that allows us to not only understand its inner workings, but also that enables us to understand the causes of its decisions. So if a model is highly interpretable, it means that it would be easy to understand why did it make a particular prediction. If this understanding can then be turned into explanations, then we can also call the model as explainable. Generally, when people solve problems, the solutions become somewhat more complicated in order to achieve more accuracy. And interpretability of solutions decreases with the increase in complexity, due to which, generally speaking, there is a dichotomy between accuracy and interpretability. Highly accurate methods are less interpretable, and highly interpretable methods are less accurate. But this paper is an attempt to break this dichotomy. It improves interpretability of a model while still being highly accurate. In particular, what it does is that it takes a neural network and replaces a part of it with a decision tree while not losing any accuracy, and even gaining a little bit of accuracy in some cases. But why do we need interpretable models? If you could have models with 100% accuracy on all the test data sets possible, then there would be not much need of interpretability. But since practical models make mistakes, it is important to understand what went wrong in case of mispredictions. Another advantage of interpretability is trustworthiness. If a model can tell us that these are the reasoning steps it took to reach a conclusion, then that will make it more trustworthy and you can feel more confident in deploying such a model. Trustworthy models are especially required in fields like medical sciences. Suppose you have a model which predicts opposite of, say, what a doctor predicts. Without interpretability, the only trust we would have for the model would be its accuracy value. But with interpretable models, we can also see how the model arrives at its decision, using which a doctor can compare their reasoning process to how the model thinks. And in this way, we can have a situation where the model provides assistance to the doctor. In other applications like self-driving car, apart from trustworthiness of the model, we can also use the interpretability of the model to understand and improve the model itself. For example, during a simulation study, in case of accident, we can then see what was the first decision of the car that could have been improved to avoid the accident. We can then use those insights to improve the model's performance. But having said that, interpretability should not come at the cost of accuracy. For example, you would not like a less accurate self-driving car which, after an accident, can completely explain how did the accident happen as compared to, you know, preventing the accident in the first place. So, how can we improve the interpretability of models while not losing accuracy? So, one of the approaches is to look where the model is paying attention in the input to arrive at its decision. For example, you can look at the saliency map of a cat and build some trust in the model that it is indeed looking at the cat to say that it's a cat. But the problem with this approach is that your model may look at the right object but can still misclassify it. And since it is looking at the right object, you don't get the insight of why did the misclassification happen. So although you can use saliency maps to visualize your model, but generally speaking, you can't always use those visualizations to improve your model. Another approach is to adopt models which perform sequential decision making, like decision trees. So if you can break the entire decision making process into a sequence of smaller meaningful decisions, then in case of mispredictions, you can minutely look at the sequence of decisions and see at which point in that sequence did the model start making mistakes. And remember, I said smaller meaningful decisions. In case of image classification, how can we do this? How can we build a decision tree with meaningful nodes inside it to make decisions? Can we even describe in sentences the split criteria chosen by various nodes at intermediate levels? If we just try to learn a decision tree like we learn it on regular machine learning datasets, with using image pixels as features to perform the split on, we don't get high accuracy in image classification. And if we go towards the route of a bunch of decision trees like a random forest classifier to increase the accuracy, then we lose the interpretability advantages that we had with a single tree model. And we know neural networks are very accurate when working with images, but they are not really interpretable. There have been works about visualizing the hidden layers, visual saliency, and other methods to try to increase the interpretability, but we can say that still we are very much behind to have true explainable reasons behind the working of these models. If we can merge neural networks and decision trees in some way and utilize the high accuracy from neural nets and combine it with the high interpretability of decision trees, then we can really progress in this direction of improved interpretability with higher performance. And this is exactly what this paper proposes. But before diving into how it combines the two, we first need to have an understanding of how hierarchical agglomerative clustering works, because it's going to be a core component of how we construct the decision tree from the neural network's weights. So in hierarchical agglomerative clustering, we start with every point as a cluster, and then we merge the closest clusters one by one. We stop when we have some, say, k clusters. So let's take an example with k is equal to 1. Here you can see all the points are in their own clusters, and you can see the Voronoi diagram for these clusters. Now in the next iteration, the clusters closest to each other will merge together, as you can see happening here. And the new cluster representative will be the mean of all the points in that cluster. And this will go on like this until you reach just one single cluster. Like this. So now we have one single cluster. And the output of this clustering algorithm is the tree which has all the points as its leaves and the intermediate nodes as the cluster representatives of the clusters formed while going through this process. The root node would be the single cluster whose cluster representative is the average of all points. Now that we know what is hierarchical agglomerative clustering, we are ready to understand how neural backed decision trees work. So suppose this is our neural network model, which works on images. Suppose we are working with a classifier, then we can represent our entire neural network in this way. We can separate the final layer from the rest of the network like this. We are going to replace this final layer with a decision tree model. So let's have a look at the final layer. Here x1, x2 till xd are the inputs to the final layer, and we can package them into a single vector x. If we ignore the bias term for now, we can say that yk for some class k is the dot product between wk and x. Note that the output class is that index k for which the dot product is the maximum. Also, although we have ignored the bias term in this analysis, but the bias term can be incorporated as well by including an additional x0 with fixed value at 1. The way we get a decision tree out of this is in this manner. Each of the wi's represent a leaf node, and then we run the hierarchical agglomerative clustering algorithm on top of this, as we discussed. Using that, we will get this falling tree-like structure, which we call as the induced hierarchy. And as you can see, each node here has its own representative vector. Here, w5 is the average of w1 and w2, and w6 is the average of w3 and w4, and so on. Also note that this we will not always combine w1 and w2 like this. It depends on the distances in the weight space. This induced hierarchy is constructed from the hierarchical agglomerative clustering algorithm. We'll always combine the most similar weights together. The way we are going to decide the sequence of decisions that we would take for an input is the following. We would take the dot product between the input vector x and the representative weight vector for all the nodes in the tree as shown here. Then we would find the probability of each of the leaf nodes by multiplying the path probabilities from the root to the leaf node, like this. And till now we have constructed a decision tree using the neural network's weights, but we have not explicitly trained this decision tree. We have only built it from the pre-trained neural net's weights. So in order to train this tree, we are going to need two loss components, The first loss component is our original cross entropy loss that we had used to train the underlying neural network. And the second loss component is also a cross entropy and it involves this term dnbdt. dnbdt is actually the probability for a class that we get by multiplying the path probabilities from the root to the leaf node of that class, as shown in this figure. So here, these are the properties for the classes, and we call this probability distribution as dnbdt. Okay, so now we know how to get a decision tree from a neural network's final layer, but how much explainable is this decision tree? Because we have used this neural network's weights to construct the decision tree, how much explainability can we expect to have here? In particular, what do the intermediate nodes mean? What smaller meaningful decisions do we carry out in those nodes? To answer this question, we can employ the technique of hypothesis testing. So what we do is that we inspect the leaves of a node, and using that inspection, we can get some idea of what the decision the node is making. For instance, suppose we identify that a node's left branch consists of all animals and its right branch consists of all objects which are not animals. So a potential hypothesis is that the node is an animal classifier. Another plausible hypothesis can be, say, it's a vehicle classifier. Then, given this hypothesis set, we can test each hypothesis in the following manner. Suppose we are testing the animal hypothesis. Then we can gather a bunch of animals which we don't already have in our data set. These are called as out of distribution or OOD examples. By calculating how many OOD examples follow our hypothesis, we can choose the best hypothesis from our hypothesis set. Although this paper introduces a type of neural network, decision tree hybrid, that increases interpretability while not losing accuracy, but we should also not forget that the assumption that tree structures are better than a neural network only holds if the intermediate decisions are explainable. So, in a way, the contributions of this paper rest on the shoulders of hypothesis testing using out-of-distribution examples. But as we can see in these examples taken from CIFAR 100 output categories, this hypothesis testing indeed works, and we get this much more interpretable decision tree constructed from the neural network's final layer. Another limitation of this approach is that since we haven't touched at all the backbone of the neural network, all of the mispredictions that happen because of the backbone remain less interpretable as before. For example, it would still be hard to figure out why the neural net misclassifies adversarial examples, because those calculations happen in the backbone of the network. So in closing, I'd like to say that this is a really nice step to break the dichotomy that was established between interpretability and accuracy, and this work shows that there are techniques yet to be found out which would not only be highly accurate but also be highly interpretable and hence trustworthy enough to be deployed in situations that are closer to human life, like self-driving cars.